Hare Krishna. Thank you for coming today evening. And I'll speak today on the topic of the time to understand time is now. I'll speak this in three broad parts. First, I'll talk about the experiential aspect of time as we experience it. Then I'll talk about the scientific understanding of time. And then I'll talk about the philosophical and devotional understanding of time and its application in our life. So, we today live in a very time-driven world. And if we had a time machine and we went back, say 500 years before, a question that we ask ourselves and we ask others very often, what is the time? That would have been very uncommon in the past. People would just look at the sky, look at the position of the sky, and they get an approximate understanding of the time. Position of the sun or whatever in the sky. And people had different devices of measuring time. But today, we are so conscious of what is the time, and we have to get to various places in time. And we all experience at some time or other the irrevocability of time. If something is not done on time, it's over. There's no chance to redo it. For me, probably the most frustrating experience of this was in my 10th standard in India, we call SSC exams. 10th standard, I started my preparation from 9th standard for 10th standard. In 9th standard only itself, by the end of 9th standard, I had almost finished studying half of my 10th standard books. So in my whole school, I was expected to be in the merit list. And in my prelims also, I did very well. My marks were way, way above what would be expected to get into the merit list. And the first exam was physics. And I was good at physics. So I completed the paper almost 30 minutes before. And then I rechecked everything. And there's something lacking. Something is missing over here. I checked it again. Nothing struck me. And then the bell rang for the time, and the examiner collected the paper, and that was the moment it struck me. I had made a mistake. All the time, as soon as it was almost as if the paper left my hand, and what was the mistake struck me. And that was one sum of 10 marks had gone wrong. And in these kind of competitive exams, 10 marks loss means it's all over. So I did well, but I missed the merit list at that time. So I was so frustrated. Initially, I was just so angry. I was banging my fist over there. Why couldn't I get this 2 minutes before? I was good at that. And even in 2 minutes, I could have redone the sum and rewritten the whole answer. But it just didn't come to me at that time. So then that was a time when it struck me that our life is so controlled by something which is beyond our control. There are of course certain factors which we understand we are beyond our control, but there is something at one moment it is in our control, at the next moment it goes out of our control. So what is that? So that was the time in India, maybe a little bit earlier, a little bit later, but that was the time in India when the Mahabharata serial was going on. And each Mahabharata episode would begin with "Main samay hoon." So that was fascinating. What is this "Main samay hoon"? Is to wonder about that. As far as our experience of time is concerned, we all have that experience. If you're going to catch a bus or a train or a flight, it's a few moments late. Yeah. Then we are. It's over. When I first took a flight in India, from India to Calcutta, one of my devotee friends called me. I was notorious for just reaching in time to catch the train. So then this devotee friend called and told me, you cannot reach in time to catch the flight. You have to reach at least 50 minutes, 60 minutes, 1 hour before, one and a half hours before. I said, what do you do 1.5 hours? He says, no, that's what you have to reach. So once I reached late, and it was a small airport in Belgao, and we reached, we saw the flight, but we couldn't get into the flight. Just we're 10 minutes late, and it's so there is this irrevocability of time that we all experience at different times in our life. And for us, we experience time as something which we need to keep track of so that we can do things. So that's a functional understanding of time. Okay, I want to do this at this time, this at this time, this at this time. And if this is not done by this time, it creates trouble. So basically, we treat time functionally as a tool or as a parameter by which we keep track of our activities. And this is one approach to understanding time. I'll come back to this approach a little later. Now, if we look at the scientific aspect of what time is. In science, if we consider the international unit of quantities or international unit of parameters, time is considered one of the seven physical quantities. And time is measured in terms of the observed repetitions within a particular, of a particular cyclical event. It may be the moving of a pendulum, or it may be the patterns of a cesium atom, which is how we measure a second, whatever it is. Einstein took this concept of time further, and he said that time and space are integrated together as space-time. So time in with respect to physics is a very curious parameter. At one level, it is a physical parameter in terms that it can be physically measured. I can measure the height, the breadth, the width. Similarly, we can measure time. So science is the language of science functions, at least physical science or what is called as hard science, that functions based on mathematics. That's why anything theory is considered serious when it is expressed in the language of mathematics. So time is very much of a parameter that is mathematically measurable. But it is unlike any other parameter. Because with respect to all other physical parameters, we can go forward and backward. If this is the length, I say this is, say, 7 inches. Then I can move my finger forward, I can move my finger backward. So if we consider motion in space, we can have forward motion, we can have backward motion. But with respect to time, we cannot have backward motion. Now, why we can't have backward motion? That is something which at a functional level, we understand that, as I said, time is irrevocable. But at a level of the philosophy of science, if time were a parameter like the parameters of space, length, breadth, width, or whatever, then why is it not reversible? That is something which as of now, science doesn't have any answers. So when Einstein integrated time as a continuum of space-time, he integrated time with space, that is one feature which is puzzling about space-time. In space, we can move backwards, but in time, we can't. And scientists still consider whether the concept of time travel is possible. Space travel is definitely possible, and we have various instruments to do that. Time travel is a popular concept in science fiction, in even romantic fiction, and various kinds of fictions. But whether time travel is even conceptually possible, that is a question which is very puzzling. And a typical problem with, say, time travel is called as the grandfather paradox. The grandfather paradox is, suppose there is a person A, and the person had a father B and his grandfather C. And if A gets on a time machine and goes into the past and meets C, before she has got married. And suppose A kills C. The grandfather never got married. So if the grandfather never got married, then the father would not be born. And if the father is not born, then this person would not be born. So he is existing, so how can he go back into the past and change some things? So some philosophers, now this time travel as of now is like a conceptual exercise. Some people say that we can go into the past, but we can't change the past. So we can just be able to travel backwards, but we just observe what we can do when we travel backwards. So the grandfather paradox has no resolution per se within science or the philosophy of science. But conceptually, if time were a parameter just like space, then both forward and backward travel would be possible. Now, even with respect to space, we can travel in space at our pace. We can travel, walk, we can drive in a car, we can drive in a plane, we can go in a spacecraft. Each at increasing space, increasing pace. Now, time travels at its own pace. Now, our experience of that travel may be relative. Einstein talked about the relativity of time, and he said that if you are sitting with a boring person, then 5 minutes can seem like 5 hours. I'm paraphrasing over here. And if you're sitting with somebody we are very attracted to, 5 hours can go like 5 minutes. Now, this is the experiential aspect of time. But as far as the actual functional aspect is concerned, time is going at its own pace. So there is an aspect of time that is beyond what we can compute or even comprehend through the normal parameters of science. With this background, if we look at the spiritual understanding of time now, there's a famous verse in the Bhagavad Gita, Kalosmi Lokakshay Krita Pravruddho. In 11.32 in the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says, time I am. And he says further, that the destroyer of all the worlds. And Oppenheimer, who was one of the prominent scientists associated with the development of the atom bomb, he, when first he tried the bomb and it worked and just destroyed a huge landmass, at that time he remembered this verse. He had been reader of the Bhagavad Gita and he felt this power is extraordinary. So time I am, the destroyer of the worlds. So it's interesting, in the Bhagavad Gita there are 2 points in this verse. Krishna is the Bhagavad Gita is spoken by Krishna, and the Bhagavad Gita itself describes Krishna to be the supreme lord, to be God. And further the Bhagavad Gita says that Bhagavad Gita is identifying Krishna with time, or time with Krishna, time I am. And secondly, at that particular phase, the Bhagavad Gita is identifying time with the destructive function. Loka kshaya krut pravruddho, kshaya, kshaya is destruction. So time, we could say, that is something which we measure with a clock, right? Or with various parameters. With respect to space, if I consider length. Now, length is a parameter of a physical object which I can measure with a tape or with some other device. So, length has an objective reality. The object itself has a reality, and length is a parameter of that object. Now, does time have an independent reality apart from our measuring of time? No. Tomorrow, if all the clocks in the world would be destroyed, would time still exist?
Yes.
If say, if if I had to write that paper and I gave my physics paper, and at that time, just before I gave my paper, if I had realized it, oh, I had to change this. And if I just pick up a stone and break the clock over there, he says, hey, the time has stopped, I'll write my paper now. So even if our measurement of time is stopped, time itself is not stopped. So we may not be able to measure time per se, but that does not mean that time itself will stop existing. Time has its self-existence separate from our capacity to measure time. And when we say time flows, the Bhagavatam gives the example of yatha ambasa anala, that just as clouds are moved by wind, similarly all living beings are moved by time. It's a very striking metaphor for three reasons. First is that the cloud is a visible and a tangible object. And the wind is invisible. It is tangible in the sense we can feel it, but otherwise we can't see it. And yet that which is tangible and visible, is that is substantial, that is moved by wind, which is completely invisible, and we can't catch wind. So in that sense it's insubstantial. So something subtle moving something gross, something visible moving something invisible. So that indicates how we, all of us, are moved by time. There's a Hindi lecture of Srila Prabhupada in which he says that koi buddha nahi hona chahta hai, par prakriti sabko chupchap buddha bana deti. He says, nobody wants to grow old, but material nature will, without any protest, quietly make everyone old. So we are all pushed by time. That time is invisible. Second parameter of this metaphor is that although the cloud is huge, the cloud has no capacity to resist the pushing of the wind. Now, normally if we are caught in, say, a flowing water, say a tsunami comes or a flood comes, and we are being swept away, at that time we might catch hold of something. We might catch hold of a branch or a pillar or something and protect ourselves from being swept away. But a cloud cannot catch hold of anything. There's nothing in the sky. The cloud will be irrevocably swept away. And similarly, all of us are also swept by time. And the third point of the metaphor is that this, when the wind starts acting and the cloud starts moving, if we are looking at the cloud, unless the cloud is very small and the cloud is close to us, we won't tangibly see the cloud moving moment to moment. But if we look now, and maybe I look at a few minutes, hey, the cloud was here, it's come over here. So the movement, which is called, the time is subtle, so the wind is subtle, and the wind causes the cloud also to move subtly. So the movement is subtle, and that's why at a moment to moment level, we don't perceive it. So similarly for us, at every moment, we are growing, we are aging, we are changing, but we don't perceive it. And it's over a period of time. Say when if a couple has a child and the child is eating every day, there is a pastime of Krishna where Krishna is not like small children, not ready to eat food. So Mother Yashoda tells Krishna that, Krishna, he says, you should drink this milk. He says, no, I don't want to drink this. He says, if you drink this milk, then you will become strong, and then when you go to herd the cows, with your strong muscles, you'll be able to control the cows. Krishna is very happy. Yes, then I want to drink milk. and he drinks a glass of milk, and then immediately he looks at his muscles. He's not grown.
And then Mother Yashoda says,
no, it will take time to drink every day. So children may expect immediate results, but we understand that nature acts, but it acts gradually. Just as growth that happens, it is, if a mother has a child, it's not that the mother will be seeing the child every day and not even notice the child is growing. But a relative comes after 3 months, 6 months, 1 year, hey, you've grown so much. So we understand this. So the effect is subtle, so it's not noticeable at a continuous level. But over a period of time, it becomes noticeable. Now, when Krishna identifies the time I am, what exactly does this mean? So he's talking about how I gave the example of a cloud to illustrate this point that time is subtle. And we might put a mathematical figure or a mathematical parameter to measure time. But that is our intellectual construct that we are putting. Time has its intrinsic self-existence separate from the construct that we may impose on it. And that Krishna is saying, it's divine. So Prabhupada explains in the first canto, in the 8th chapter, 22nd verse, Kunti Maharani is praying and she says, Manye tvam kalam ishanam anadinidhanam vibhum samam charantam sarvatra bhutanam yanmithakali. He says, Manye tvam kalam ishanam. I consider you to be time, the supreme controller. Anadinidhanam vibhu. Anadi means no beginning and no end. So it's interesting, what is being said is time has no beginning and no end. Time causes things to begin and move towards the end. But time itself has no beginning and no end. Now, before I go into this point of what we mean by God is time, I'll take one more philosophical concept. And then I'll end with the philosophy. It will not become too much of an overdose. But there is a philosophical question that often people, atheists, they ask this question. That you say God created everything. Then who created God? In fact, there's an atheist who says this is the ultimate question to refute theism, belief in God. So this is the ultimate unanswerable question. Well, the question is unanswerable only till we question the question itself. There are some questions which cannot be answered without questioning the foundation of that question. What does that mean? Suppose somebody asks a man, have you stopped beating your wife? Now, if you say yes or if you say no, in both cases you are trapped. Yeah. If you say no, shameless guy, you are still beating your wife. If you say yes, that means you acknowledge you are beating your wife before. So, before that question can be answered, we have to question the foundation of the question itself. You know, who says that I beat my wife? So, like that, when you ask who created God, The question needs to be asked is, who said that God needs to be created by anyone? And you say, why? If everything is created, why should God not be created? Every field of knowledge has to begin with certain definitions. And for most people, their knowledge of God begins with the depiction of God, not the definition of God. So the depiction of God means, they may say a particular image in a temple or a particular form. And they think, okay, you call this is God. This is just one person over here. And when you think this person just looks like me, this person just looks like you. And how can this be God? You think, okay, this painting was created by so and so, this image was created by so and so. So like that, if we say depiction, if we do, if we start with depiction, then we will misunderstand God. We have to start with definition. The definition of God is sarva karana karanam. So this is important to understand that when why is this related to our discussion is, first I'll answer the question, then I'll come back to the discussion. So if somebody says who created God, the definition of God is the cause of all causes. If anyone or anything created God, then that person would be God. The creator of God would be the actual God. So wherever the chain of cause and effect stops, that is the point that is God. So to another simple example to understand this would be, say if a child reads a novel for the first time and likes all the characters in the novel. Oh, this character, okay. This child is this person's son. And this is son, his father is this one, his father is this one. The child looks at all the genealogy and understands everything. And then after reading the book, the child comes to know, oh, this book is written by author. Say if somebody reads Harry Potter. And then they come to know that, oh, this is written by J.K. Rowling. Then the child starts reading the whole book. Where is J.K. Rowling in the book? Now, J.K. Rowling is not inside the book. She created the timeline. She created the storyline. She created the characterization of the characters. She created the plot twists. But she exists outside the book. So similarly, God, when we ask who created God, the implicit assumption there is that God is a creation within time. But God is not a creation within time. God is the creator of time. God is not created through time. God creates through time. God has a self-existence beyond time and He creates through time. So when we understand this point that God exists, Sat Asat Param, the Bhagavad Gita says that there is the cause-effect chain in this world and the Absolute exists beyond the cause-effect chain. And therefore, this question itself indicates you don't understand what God is. That if somebody asks who created God, the question itself indicates that one doesn't understand the conception of God. Asking who created God is like asking who made a circle circular. Who made a circle circular? Well, you can circle by definition is circular. Similarly, God, by definition, is the cause of all causes. So He doesn't have a cause. And how do so this, that God exists outside time and He causes, He creates through time. And time, through time, so when Bhagavad Gita says, Kalosmi, I am time. That means this energy which brings about the change, that energy is time, that is a manifestation of God. So this irrevocable, unstoppable force that propels us from birth to death, that is God manifesting in this world. So Srila Prabhupada says that atheists may decide that we are not going to bow down to God. That's fine. But when death comes, everybody has to bow down. So that is when even a person who does not believe in God has to bow down to God. So now time brings about three distinct changes. You could say there is creation, maintenance and destruction. In the Bhagavad Gita, first Krishna identifies that I am time. And then he says, I am the destroyer of all the worlds. So it's interesting, Krishna doesn't identify over there that I am the creator, I am the maintainer. He says, I am the destroyer. He could identify very well with that also. But that brings us to the context. of the Gita. This particular verse comes in the 11th chapter. And the 11th chapter is probably the most dramatic chapter of the Bhagavad Gita in terms of visual drama. The remaining chapter remaining is it's all intellectual drama. So it's internal. Oh, you understand this concept. And in the 11th chapter, Arjuna asks Krishna, Manyasedi tashakyam mayadrashtumiti prabho yogeshwar tato metvam darshayatmanam avyayam. So in 11.4 he says, oh Krishna, if you think it is possible for me, then please let me see your universal form. And the Bhagavad Gita adopts a very interesting narrative structure to describe the form, that universal form. So normally, when we see something which is very unusual, which is very dazzling, we can't make sense of it. So normally we think we make sense of things with what we see with our eyes. However, what we see with our eyes doesn't make sense unless our intelligence makes sense of things. Suppose a person from a completely rural area who has never heard of a stock market, that person wanders into a stock exchange. And he says, everybody is sitting looking glued at a big screen. And then on that big screen, one line crashes down and everybody catches it. What is the big deal? Now, so one line went down on the screen. What are you so worried about it? So actually, we see not with our eyes, but with our intelligence. So the universal form that Arjuna is going to see is so extraordinary that the Bhagavad Gita, while describing, adopts a threefold descriptive structure. So first, from verses 5 to 8 in the 11th chapter, before Krishna reveals the universal form, he tells Arjuna what I am going to reveal. So that Arjuna can make sense. This is what you are going to see. So adrushta purvam, nobody has seen this before you. Arjuna, I will show it to you. And then in the 9th verse, the Bhagavad Gita is actually a conversation between Krishna and Arjuna, which is reported by Sanjay to Dhritarashtra. So in the 9th verse, Sanjay then says, then Yogeshwara darshayat atmanupam, that Yogeshwar Lord, he revealed his form. And then text 10 to 13 gives Sanjay's description of the universal form, of what Sanjay is showing. And in 14th verse says, it gives Arjuna's reaction first. Arjuna starts trembling, he folds his hands and he offers his obeisances. And then from verse 15 to verse 31, there is Arjuna's description of what he is seeing. So first, Krishna describes what he will show. Then Sanjay describes what Krishna is showing. And then Arjuna is describing what I am seeing. And when Arjuna describes what he is seeing, he starts by seeing. He has asked to see the universal form and he is delighted. He says, Pashyami Vishveshwara Vishwarupa. Oh Lord of universe, I see your universal form. Now as he is seeing it, initially he says, oh, there are heads over here everywhere, there are hands, aneka bahu daravaktra netram. So hands everywhere, eyes everywhere, faces everywhere. It's a majestic form. And vismitosmi, he's filled with astonishment. But then as he's looking at this universal form, now the universal form of Krishna, he has shown it several times in the past. The Mahabharata war happens at a particular time, the Kurukshetra war happens at a particular time in the life of Krishna and the Pandavas. So which are the times before this when Krishna has shown the universal form? Yes? Varaha. That is another time. That is entire another avatar itself.
When he goes to as a
peace messenger. Yes, very good. That is one time when he shows as a peace messenger. When Duryodhana tries to arrest Krishna, and Krishna just expands in a huge form and all the soldiers fall back. That's one time. Good. Thank you. Any other time? Yes, Yashodamai. She says, Krishna, show me your mouth. And he opens his mouth and she sees, amazingly enough, the whole universe, and not only sees the whole universe, in the universe she sees Vrindavan. And in the universe she sees herself. She says, what is this? Is this Maya? Am I an illusion? What is, she just can't make sense of anything. So if we, so these are two main occasions. Now after this, once more also Krishna shows a universal form to a sage. But let's compare these three reactions, which will say Yashoda's reaction, Duryodhana's reaction, and then Arjuna's reaction. Now when Yashoda sees, he says, first he says, hey, what is this? Am I dreaming? She pinches herself. She says, no, I'm awake. And this is really, this is my child. But is it really my child? How am I seeing this? Has Maya Devi created some illusion? He said, but I'm just an innocent cowherd girl. Why, cowherd woman? Why would Maya bother to create me, put in an illusion? Does my child have some mystic powers? Has he created some illusion like this? Yeah, Gargamuni had said that this child is extraordinary like Narayan. And maybe my child has extraordinary mystic powers. That's why he has created an illusion like this. But how can he have mystic power? When he doesn't get milk on time, he cries. So, I was thinking like this, and she just closes her eyes. And when Krishna sees, Krishna has a particular flavor in his relationship with Yashoda. So that flavor is that he wants her love as a mother. And he wants to reciprocate with her as her son. Sometimes Krishna may reveal his divinity, but that is just occasional for some particular Leela purposes. But in Vrindavan, his major flavor of the relationship is, oh, he's just a lovable cowherd boy. So Krishna says that this is Rasabhas. I don't want Yashoda might be praying to me. So he exercises his illusory potency, my potency, and the whole universal form disappears. And when Mother Yashoda opens her eyes again and she sees, oh, the whole universal form disappeared. And by the arrangement of Yoga Maya, okay, this is my child. She picks him up and, oh, he ate mud. He must be hungry. Let me feed him. And she forgets everything. So for her, there's a temporary realization of Krishna's divinity. But all that happens in the end result is there is an intensification of her affection for Krishna. In the case of Duryodhana, he thinks that Krishna is a prominent warrior. If I can arrest him, then the odds will turn dramatically in my favor. That's why he decides to arrest Krishna. But when he comes to arrest Krishna, he just falls back. In fact, the universal form is so dazzling at that time. There's fire coming from the eyes, sparks coming from the ears. And it's so, such a fierce form. That actually most people faint, and those who don't faint, they have to close their eyes. They can't just see this form. By Krishna's inconceivable arrangement, those whose eyes are open, they get closed. But the one person whose eyes are closed, Krishna arranges for his eyes to be opened. Who is that? Dhritarashtra. So Dhritarashtra says, oh Krishna, I want to see your universal form. And Krishna says, Tathastu. Krishna gives him eyes to see. But actually again, Duryodhana has the eyes to see, but he closes the eyes. Dhritarashtra doesn't have the eyes to see, Krishna gives him the eyes. He sees, but still he does not see. Pashyan api na pashyati. For neither of them, their hearts change. They say, then later on, how does Duryodhana explain this? Before the Kurukshetra war, the previous night, Duryodhana is so cocky, so cocksure that I am going to win this war. He feels as if there is not even going to be a fight. You just have 7 Akshamunis, I have 11. I have Bhishma and Drona with me. You will just be crushed. And in order to have some fight, he sends Uluka. Uluka is the son of Shakuni. And he sends Uluka to the Pandavas to give very insightful messages, not insightful in the sense of INSIGHT, but INCIT. Insight, something which went to incite the message, incite them. And he insults everyone through that message. Now when Huluka goes, like sometimes if we have to convey a very unpleasant message to someone, the first thing you say, I am not saying this, sir. This person is saying this. I am only the messenger. As they say, don't shoot the messenger. So like that Uluka, he tells Yudhishthir, you know, O king, according to the time-honored codes, a messenger is never to be punished. So Yudhishthir says, don't worry, don't be rest assured of your safety. But then he starts conveying Duryodhana's message and he insults everyone. And then he speaks to Krishna. Means he is basically conveying Duryodhana's message to Krishna. And he says, Krishna, when you came as a peace messenger, you showed a magical form. He says, I can also show many magical forms. But those magical forms are not going to work on this war field. So show whatever forms you want to know, show. But I am going to show my prowess and I am going to win the war. So he explains it away. He said, this is just some magic which Krishna did and he deceived us. That means that if somebody does not have a desire, at least a spark of a desire to turn towards Krishna, to become devoted to Krishna, to become spiritual, that person, even if they see God himself, even if they see God in his huge majesty as a universal form, even then their heart will not change. I wrote a book on reincarnation called Demystifying Reincarnation, in which I gave many cases of past life children who remembered the past lives. So after I wrote the book, I did a further study to look at these children's future lives. Many of them had vivid, irrefutable memories of past lives. And yet, not even one of these children became spiritually minded because of that. Yes, I had a past life. I know I met my parents from that past life. I met my relatives. But let me move on with this life. So that knowledge was there, but that remembrance of the past life did not necessarily promote any spirituality. It can, but it is not that recollection is the cause of spirituality. It is our own choice. It is our own intention. Now, so if that intention is not there, whether we remember our past lives or whether Krishna comes right in front of us, nothing is going to change. Now, in the case of Arjuna, let us see what is the effect. So Arjuna sees the universal form and he's thrilled. He is vismit, astounded. But then, so from his description starts from the 15th verse. And then as he moves forward in describing, first, he's just describing and appreciating. Oh, durnirikshyam samanta. There's such a blazing form that I cannot see it properly. But then slowly, that reaction from astonishment moves towards apprehension. And bhayena cha pravatitam manome. That with fear, my mind is completely afflicted. And then by the end, when he says, Dhamshtra karalani jate mukhani drishtvaiva kalanal sannibhani, he says, the fire of destruction is coming from your mouth. And everyone and everything around you is getting destroyed. And first he sees that actually there are all these gods who are offering praise to the Vishwarupa. And then he sees that there is this fierce fire coming out. And then he sees actually all the warriors in the Kurukshetra war itself, they are entering into that fire. And he becomes alarmed. And then, initially, when Krishna surrenders to Arjuna surrenders to Krishna, he says, Pruchhami tvam dharma sammuda chetaha. He says, I ask you, please tell me what is dharma. But then, when he sees this fierce form, he says, Akhyahimeko bhavanu grarupo nahi prajanami tava pravrittim. He says, I ask you, who are you? And here he uses a very respectful second person address, Bhavan. In English, we just have you as a second person address. In Hindi, we have tu and aap. Sometimes you may pick up a phone call. Kaun hai tu? Aap kaun ho? We may change it. So like that, so Arjuna's address changes from Tuam to Bhavan. Akhya hi me ko Bhavan ugra rupo. And now please tell me who you are. Now what does this question mean? Who are you? That means, now obviously, he knows it is Krishna who is showing the universal form. And is already told that I am seeing your universal form. But why is it that suddenly he asks, who are you? So, it is, there are two metaphors I'll give to understand, explain this. Suppose, I'll come back later. This is very interesting. So then Krishna says, I am time, I am the destroyer, you should fight this war. And then Krishna says, Arjuna offers his prayer and he says, please, I don't want to see this form anymore. It's a glorious form. It's an awesome form. I'm grateful to see it, but I don't want to see it anymore. And then Krishna teases Arjuna. He says, actually, it's a very rare form. Nobody will be able to see it. You got to say, no, I don't want to see it again. So, okay. Then Krishna says, okay, I don't want to say it to you. So, it's a, say, if you turn on a TV, if a child turns on a TV and sees a movie going on, and that movie seems to be some interesting movie going on, some nice visual effects are there, and then suddenly you find that movie like a horror movie. Everything is being destroyed, everyone is being killed. And then, as you keep watching it, what happened? And suddenly you see, as if in that movie, your own house is being destroyed. It's scared. And then you try to press the, I don't want to watch this movie, you try to press the remote to change the movie and the remote doesn't work. Hey, what is this? So for Krishna, for Arjuna, it becomes like that. Hey, what is this? It's just like a remote vision, majesty of God is fine. But when he sees everyone around him being destroyed, he just can't bear it. That's one metaphor. The other metaphor would be, when he's asking, who are you? Why is he asking like this? Suppose, say, we know someone. And we know them to be very nice, gentle, sweet person. And suddenly one day, they start shouting and yelling and snarling and speaking all kinds of harsh words. Who are you? What did you do to my friend? Many times when parents have children and the children go into teenage, and the parents wonder, when the child was small, such a nice, sweet person, and who is this sullen, uncommunicative teenager who has come in his place? So, it just happens when we think we know someone, and then that person starts exhibiting a characteristic that is completely out of character with what we know of them. Then we ask, who are you? So, similarly, now in the Vishwarupa, when Krishna showed the Vishwarupa previously to Yashoda as well as to Duryodhana, at that time, he basically showed the spatial aspect of the Vishwarupa. How it's so huge, how all the gods in the universe are present in the form of the Lord. The spatial dimension of the Vishwarupa was shown. But there is the dimension of space and there is a dimension of time. And within the Vishwarupa, the dimension of time is called the Kala Rupa. So that Kala Rupa is shown by Krishna to Arjuna only. And that is why when Arjuna asks the question, who are you? Krishna does not say, I am Krishna. Krishna doesn't even say, I am Vishwarupa. He says, I am Kala. So this unfamiliar within the familiar. What is that? So within the Vishwarupa, the Kala manifestation Krishna shows, that Arjuna can't identify. And Krishna identifies that for him. Time I am. And then Arjuna becomes very reverential. He offers his prayers and he says, now normally if we come to a house and we see there's a temple over there, we'll maybe offer obeisances. I says, this is divine. So he says, I have to offer obeisances, but where do I offer obeisances? The Vishwarupa is everywhere. So he says that, I'll offer obeisances from front, I offer obeisances from right, I offer obeisances from left, I offer obeisances hundreds of times to you. Puna Purastada Vishwarupa. He says, from front, from back, I offer you obeisances. In this way, he just is in complete awe. So, I said that time has the aspects of creation, maintenance and destruction. Now, the Kurukshetra war is the time of destruction. And that's why at that place, Krishna stresses, I am the destroyer. So, Krishna could very well in another context say, I am a time and time the creator. I could say time, I am time, time the maintainer. But at that particular point, he stresses, I am time, the destroyer. Now for us as devotees, when we are trying to practice, understand spirituality, apply it in our lives, this understanding of time is significant. Now Prabhupada would quote Chanakya Pandit about the irreplaceability of time, that even one moment of time cannot be got back by giving thousands of dollars, thousands of gold coins also. So that is the utilitarian conception of time, that time is a very valuable resource and that we need to use properly. But the Bhagavad Gita offers us another understanding of time. Time is not significant just because we can do something valuable with it. That is the utilitarian conception of time. But time is significant intrinsically. Intrinsically, it is significant because time is a manifestation of God. Time is not just valuable or invaluable, time is sacred. And when we value Krishna as time, or rather when we value time as Krishna, the time is a gift that Krishna has given me. Krishna has come as a gift to me. When we value time and use that time for serving Krishna, then Krishna takes us beyond the domain of time. So to the extent we see time as Krishna and we engage our time in the service of Krishna, then time will take us towards Krishna. Time will take us towards Krishna. Whatever time we do, at a horizontal level, time is going to take every one of us towards old age, disease and death. But if at a level of consciousness, we appreciate that time is Krishna, then there will be this parallel journey that will happen. This body will go towards its inevitable destruction. But the soul will rise in its consciousness. And when the soul rises in its consciousness, the soul comes closer and closer towards Krishna. So, Bhakti Yoga is the process of taking us from the arena of time to the arena of timelessness. The arena of time is this material world where we are controlled by time. And the body will inevitably be controlled. But if we learn to serve Krishna, if we learn to devote ourselves to Krishna, understanding that time is a manifestation of Krishna meant to connect us with Krishna, then this very time can elevate us towards Krishna. The Bhagavatam says that Ayur Harati Vai Pumsam Udyan Astancha Jasasau, that with every rising and setting of the sun, the lifespan is getting over of people, except for those who are engaged in the glorification of Lord Hari. When we glorify Krishna, by glorifying Krishna, by hearing the glories of Krishna, we become attracted to Him. This is basic human psychology. Whatever we hear about repeatedly, we'll become attracted to it. and an Indian in India may be mad after cricket. And Indian in India may not even know about rugby or basketball much. But that same Indian comes to America and is in university where everybody is mad after basketball. First, when he comes, he doesn't know anything about basketball. 6 months later, he'll be cheering like mad for the basketball team.
Yes.
What has happened? Just by exposure. Exposure. So whatever we are exposed to, everywhere, oh, this match is so exciting, this player is so good, this team is so great. Just hear about it, we become attracted. So similarly, if we keep hearing about Krishna, hearing about his glories, then we become attracted to him. And the more we become attracted to him, the more our consciousness becomes elevated. And when the consciousness becomes elevated, basically, at the time of death, which will come for every one of us, if we are more attached to Krishna than we are attached to the world, then Krishna will take us out of this world. That Krishna is simply reciprocating with our desires. If Krishna becomes our foremost attachment, then he takes us out of this world. So that is the time when we unite with Krishna. So when you say the time to understand time is now, that is the title. What it means is that we understand this irrevocability of time. We understand the divinity of time. And we see time as a precious opportunity for connecting with Krishna. If we start practicing bhakti wholeheartedly, using whatever we have, time we have to invest our consciousness in Krishna, to connect our consciousness with Krishna, then we will understand that Krishna is already with us. It is not that Krishna is a destination to be attained. Actually, I'll conclude with this example, that for us, suppose we are going to meet some VIP and say we are going to LA, we're going by a flight, and you've never seen that VIP before, so we're excited. When, how will I meet him? When will I see him? And then we get there, we go to that person's house, we knock on the door, and we open the door, and they open the door, and they welcome. They say, welcome. And then we notice, to our astonishment, that the person who opened the door was the same person who was sitting next to us in our flight, throughout our flight. But because we didn't know that person, so we didn't appreciate that that person was with us right now. So similarly for us, Krishna is not just a person whom we will meet when we get back to the spiritual world. Krishna is right now with us. Krishna is present in our hearts, the Paramatma. Krishna is present in the world as a force of time. Krishna is present in the world as his deity manifestation. Krishna is present as the holy name. Krishna is present as the bhakti scriptures, as the Bhagavad Gita, as the Bhagavatam. And so Krishna is not just a destination to be attained, he is a companion to be realized. How far away is Krishna from us? He is just one thought away. He is just one thought away. We just think about Krishna, we can feel his presence, we can connect with him. And that one thought, which is Krishna, the Atma is here, the Paramatma is here. The bridge between the Atma and the Paramatma is just one thought. And that thought, we have the opportunity to think of right now. At this very moment, we can build a bridge between ourselves and our Lord by thinking about him. And when we do that, then we experience Krishna's presence in the here and now. And thus, bhakti can make not just the end of our journey relishable, but bhakti can make our journey itself relishable. That it happens when we realize the proximity of Krishna for us. And time is a manifestation which we are almost always conscious of. And if we can connect that consciousness with Krishna, actually, this moment is an opportunity given by Krishna to me. Let me use it the best way I can. Let me see that this is Krishna manifesting as time. in the Chaitanya Charitamrit, that is when the Gaur Purnima in Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's appearance is described, at that time Krishnadas Kaviraj Goswami says that I offer obeisances to that Purnima day on which Lord Chaitanya appeared. It's not that I offer obeisances to Lord Chaitanya, I offer obeisances to that day, because that day is also sacred. So time for us is sacred, and when we connect with the supreme sacred reality with the time that we have, then our life becomes spiritualized and sanctified, supremely sanctified. So I'll summarize. I spoke on the topic of the time to understand time is now. I started by the experiential understanding of time. We keep track of time so that we can get our things done. And we realize the irrevocability of time. If something is not done on time, it's lost forever. Like for me in my 10th standard exam, just few moments delay and I just lost the merit rank forever. And now, this, in the past we were not so conscious about the specific units of time. We didn't, time existed although our time measuring devices didn't exist. So in science, time is considered to be like a parameter, like length, breadth, width, length, breadth, height, whatever. But it is distinct because it cannot be taken backwards and its forward movement can't be changed, which can be done within space. The grandfather paradox prevents in conception also time travel in towards backwards. So time, apart from as we measure it, does it have any independent existence? Yes, so that even if clocks were destroyed, time would exist. So what is time independent of as it is measured in science? So that the Bhagavad Gita says time is a manifestation of the divine. I give the example of how the clouds are pushed by the wind. Similarly, we are all pushed by time. So this three significance of this metaphor is the subtle is pushing the gross. The gross has no capacity to resist the subtle. And the gross is being pushed so subtly that at a moment-to-moment level, we can't perceive it. But gradually, in incremental, intermittent levels, we can perceive it. And then I talked about who created God? The atheistic question. He says that question has an assumption which needs to be challenged. It's like, have you stopped beating your wife? Don't answer the question, question the question first. So the question in the question means, who told you that God is a created being? So God is the cause of all causes. He is like the author who is not present as a specific character in the novel, but is the creator of everything in the novel. So God is not created by time, but rather God creates time and creates through time. God exists beyond time. And then I talked about, the Bhagavad Gita says that time, I am the destroyer of the worlds. So why the destroyer? In that connection, I told Krishna's manifesting the Vishwarupa, how he manifested to Yashoda, manifested to Duryodhana and to Arjuna. Yashoda just became, she was bewildered temporarily, but her devotion intensified. Duryodhana was also overwhelmed initially, was baffled, but his animosity did not go down. He persevered, he obstinately went on with his evil intentions. Krishna, when he showed the Vishwarupa to Arjuna, Arjuna initially admired the Vishwarupa. Now, Krishna first describes what I am showing you, and Sanjay says what is being shown, and then Arjuna describes what is being shown. We don't see just with our eyes, we see with our intelligence that helps us to make sense of what we are seeing with our eyes. So the Bhagavad Gita gives an adequate preface to make sense of the Vishwarupa. And yet, Arjuna's initial astonishment changes into alarm as he is beholding the Vishwarupa. Why? Because he sees the destructive aspect of it. So it's like a child watching a horror movie. So watching a movie which suddenly turns to be a horror movie, and not just about something far away, but your own house is being destroyed. Or we have a friend with whom we are talking, and that friend suddenly starts becoming furious in a way we have never seen before. So we ask, who are you? So when Arjuna sees this destructive form, he asks, who are you? Then Krishna replies, he says, I am time. So the time, Kala Rupa, is never shown by Krishna to anyone else. It's shown only to Arjuna. And because the war is a place of destruction, so Krishna emphasizes, I'm the destroyer of the worlds. So what happens to Arjuna after seeing this Kala Rupa is that he offers respectful obeisances, he surrenders to Krishna. He becomes an instrument of Krishna, he becomes devoted to Krishna. Similarly for us, when we understand the Kala aspect, then we too can become devoted to Krishna. So time is not just an invaluable resource for us to use for some constructive purposes. Time is itself sacred. And time is a manifestation of God. And to the extent we appreciate time as a manifestation of God and use the time to serve Krishna, to the extent, although our body will go towards destruction, our soul will rise towards liberation by the increased attachment towards Krishna. And as we appreciate Krishna's presence in this world, as time, as the deities, as the holy name, as the sacred scriptures, then we understand that Krishna is not just a destination to be attained, but he's also a companion to be realized, whose presence is to be realized. And Krishna is always just one thought away from us. So the time to understand time is now. The time to think of Krishna is now. The time to bridge the distance between the Atma and the Paramatma is now. And the time to live in the presence of Krishna is now. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna. Thank you. Any questions or comments? Yes, Krishnaji Prabhu.
I have one question, Prabhu. We started time as a quantity, as a unit. So, time is always finite. You know, and you gave an example of time machine that people want to go backwards and forward. So, do the time stays finite in those conditions? We have a scriptural reference, like we are, you know, living beings, special, especially empowered. They travel time, and they were, like, you know, there were changes. But do time stays finite for everyone?
Are you talking about time's finiteness or time's unchangingness?
Well, in terms of, like, you know, a person comes up with a fixed time, like we say, we have fixed number of breath. In that level, in time.
Oh, so your question is our lifespan finite, yes. Fixed? Yes. Is that your question?
Like, the concept is like you cannot regain time. Like, what time is lost, is lost. Like, I'm working, failed an experiment. I may do it again, but the time lost can never be, you know. But then we see these examples, like, you know, coming up either modern technologically. They say, oh, we can go back and we can get back that time in our life. Or we can go ahead in time. But as a unit, as I feel, time will always be finite. We will go back or forward.
What do you mean by the word finite in this? I'm not understanding the word.
If our life span is, say, 60 years now, even if you go back, would it change anything?
Okay.
The unit aspect of time.
Okay.
And so then we see scriptures, where we see, like, you know, yugas, take example of Balram, Lord Balram's wife, like when she came back, Satyuga and all manifestations were so different.
Okay, good question. So is time always finite? Whether in science we talk about, or in science fiction talk about going back in time or going ahead in time, or in our scriptures we talk about going across different levels of the universe where time flows differently. So, is time always finite? Okay. There are two different aspects over here which we need to understand. See, time is also a part of the universal arrangement of karma and reaction and reaction. So when we say in the heavenly planets time flows slower, or they live longer, whichever way you want to put it, they live longer. So 6 months here, can be just one moment over there. 1 year over here, can be one day for Brahma. When we say this, what does it literally mean? What it means is that ultimately time causes change. And we want to live happily forever, as we say. That's the idea in romantic movies, romantic novels. We want to be happy. So that eternal happiness is present in the spiritual world. So we could envision the effect of time, or the manifestation, not effect, the manifestation of time, like a pyramid. So like a pyramid means, at the top is the spiritual world. In the spiritual world, there is what I say, the eternal present. That's what the Brahma Samhita says. That this time is eternal. Krishna is a 16-year-old youth. Radharani is a 15-year-old young girl. But that is how they stay eternally. In the spiritual world, time exists, but time doesn't exist as the controller. It is not that when Krishna is performing pastimes with Radharani in the forest, he says, looks at his watch, hey, time over, now I have to go. Krishna, time is a part of the spiritual world for facilitating the pastimes of Krishna. So time does change. It's morning, some Krishna does some activities, afternoon Krishna does some activities, evening Krishna does other activities, night he has different pastimes. But in none of these, Krishna is controlled by time. Rather, time is controlled by Krishna. So if we, in that sense, it's eternal present. That means time does not have any controlling capacity. Whatever Krishna wants, Krishna does through that. But if we consider time like a pyramid moving down, 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 down. So one moment in the spiritual world can be like eternity in the material world, because it's a pyramid which moves downwards. Now, within that pyramid, as I said, time is a part of the universal arrangement through which we get our karma comes upon us. So those who live in the heavens, they go there because they have done punya, because they have done virtuous work, and therefore they are meant to enjoy the fruits of their virtue for a long time. Te punya masadhi surendra lokam ashnanti divyan divideva bhogan. Krishna says, those who yagya do yagya punya and go to heavens, they enjoy immense heavenly delights. So the idea is, the slow flow of time in the heavens correlates with their being able to enjoy the heavenly delights for a long time. The fast flow of, relatively speaking, fast flow of time on the earth is correlating with, we all have done some finite karmas. And because of the finite, we have some finite good karma, finite bad karma. So whatever good we are also meant to enjoy, that is for a finite time. We can't really enjoy for very long in this world. Even if we work hard and get all the enjoyable objects for us, they'll be there for a short time for us. So time is finite in the sense that time is a part of this finite material world. The time that we have is finite. Time as a unit, is it finite? That's an interesting question, because if we consider the history of the universe as explained in the Vedic scriptures in conceptual terms, the pradhan, the unmanifested material nature, exists. And when Vishnu glances, sa aikshitaha sa asrujyata, the Upanishads say that by the glance creation begins. At a philosophical level, what this means is, through the glance, the material nature is impregnated with the souls, and material nature is activated through time. So then the material nature starts becoming active. And so that time is injected as the activating agent. Just like if we are cooking food, then at that time we may have a pan. Now we have to put the right ingredients above and we have put the flame below. When the right ingredients are above, the flame is below, then the items get cooked. So like that, the right ingredients coming from above are the souls who are injected in the material world. and the right, the flame coming from below is like time. And then through that, all the souls start getting manifested. So herein, time is seen as something which activates. So now, when the creation is unmanifested, does time exist at that time? Time exists in the sense that it is an energy of the divine which is withdrawn into him. So it is said that the universe is created at a particular time, the universe exists for a particular time, the universe is destroyed, it enters into the gigant, in the huge form of Vishnu, and then after some time it becomes manifested. So there is a cosmic time scale that is described for all this. That indicates that time still exists, because according to cosmic time scale it is happening. But within the universe, time is finite. Time is finite for us as we live the world. And when somebody moves from this level to another level, it is that they cannot move unless they have the punya to move. That's why when Arjuna goes to the heavens, he considers it's even as Dhritarashtra is astounded. How can anyone go to the heaven in the self-same body? And he says, I got to see Mahadasanartham. Ardham. He said, I got to sit on the same throne as Indra by his side. Because Indra treated Arjuna as his son and he got to sit on his side. So he says there that means that person, if they have to go in the self-same body, they have to have that special punya. Or there has to be special grace of the Lord. Something extraordinary. So if somebody is to experience the expanded lifespan of the heavens, then that person has to go to the heavens for that time. And that person has to go to the heavens, they have to have that necessary punya. So Arjuna does the lot of tapasya to get to the heavens. Now it's interesting that same relativity of time which say we have in that pastime of some other pastimes, like say Indradyumna Maharaj, he goes up to the heavens and he comes back and he finds that all the kings of his time are already gone. Or the same happens with Revati's mother, Balram's wife's father, when he wants to get a consort husband for her. But when Arjuna goes to heaven and comes back, that doesn't happen. Arjuna goes to heaven and he comes back and it's lifespan goes on. So how does it work like that? See, the whole idea there is that time exists for the purpose of serving the Lord and for his leela as is appropriate it happens. So in that case, Arjuna goes to the heavens, and by going to the heavens, multiple purposes are served. First is that he himself gets mystical powers from the gods. Second is that he serves the mission of the gods, because Indra has some demons whom he is not able to kill, the Nimat Kavachas, and Arjuna kills them. And then he, by coming back after going to the heavens, he serves the purpose that for Duryodhana and for his opponents, that he is such a powerful person that he could not only go to heaven and come back, but he could even kill the demons whom the gods could not kill. So that whole pastime is arranged in such a way that it should serve as a deterrent for Duryodhana. You can't fight a person like this. And this person has defeated, Arjuna had defeated all the gods in Khandav. And then he defeated the demons whom the gods couldn't defeat when he went on behalf of Indra. So how can you fight against such an enemy? So in this case, that purpose of deterrence is to be served. So he goes into that time zone when he comes back, but it is just that finite amount of time. It is not that millennia have passed off. Of course, we could also say that Arjuna doesn't go to Brahmaloka. The distance between Swarga and Mrityaloka is relatively lesser. Brahmaloka is much higher. But the point is that time warping or that time zone shift, that time shifting, that is not manifested so much in the Mahabharata. Okay. Thank you. Yes, Phil.
Prabhu.
Yeah.
My question is, one of the common complaints that we see in the modern times is that people say we don't have much time to do things.
Mm.
And when we compare our situation with maybe 10 or 20 years ago, we see that there has been a rapid development in terms of science, and especially in technology. The main purpose of technology is that we want to get things done faster and save time. We have smartphones, we have faster travel from one place to other. So where is this contradiction coming from? Because things are progressed to save time, but still people complain that we don't have time.
That's true.
Yeah.
So why is it that we have got so many devices and technological progress which is meant to save time, but still we feel that we don't have time? See, there is in 1920 there was a best American thinker who wrote that essay, quite a well-known essay. He says that within 20 years the biggest problem before humanity will be what to do with all the idle time that we have, because machines will do all the work that we are doing and people will not know what to do with, what to do with their time. Now, yes, we machines are doing a lot of work that we are doing, that we used to do earlier, but somehow we just don't have time. So, what, where, as you said, why is this paradox coming? There are multiple reasons for this. One thing is that actually our time is taken not so much by our activity as by our mentality. What do I mean by this? That, say, we normally think of our time in terms of our schedule, in terms of our activities, okay? Morning, I'll do this. If somebody is a student, okay, I have this class from this time to this time, and this class from this time to this time, this class from this time to this time. Like that, we may divide our time in terms of the activity that we are doing. But suppose someone, say we go, a student goes to a class, we go to a class, and then just before we go to the class, enter the class, we greet someone as another student, and that student completely snubs us. That 1 hour class, her mind is filled with revenge fantasies. Next time in public in front of everyone, I'll snub this person. How will I get this opportunity? How will I do this? Now, in terms of our schedule, that 1 hour has actually gone for that class. But in reality, that 1 hour, this is gone with the thought of the mind. So what often most time management or time analysis tools or whatever measuring tables or whatever they don't recognize is that time is taken not just by activities. Time is taken by thoughts. And one thought can actually take hours and hours. Somebody is studying for an exam, but they get a thought, okay, there is this cricket match going on, let me watch it. And they start watching it and they can consume by it and they may spend 6 hours watching it. And then they think, oh my God, I got an exam coming up, what did I do? So that 6 hours, in this case, of course, externally they did some other activity.
Mm-hmm.
But sometimes we just lose our time in our head. This thought, it just goes on and on. So basically, one of the characteristics of Kali Yuga that is described in the Bhagavatam is the last characteristics. Prayan alpayushu sabhya kalavasmin yugajana manda sumanda matyo manda bhagya ya upadrutaha. So yeah means certainly. So even if the previous characteristics are not present, but this last characteristic is surely present. What is that? Upadrutaha. Upadruta means people are disturbed. So because of the disturbed minds, now, sometimes we talk about disturbed mind in terms of if somebody is very agitated, hey, what if this happens, what if that happens, that what happened, that's not normally we consider as a disturbed mind. And sometimes some even materialistic people may not seem to be disturbed that way. They may be very focused. This is what I'm going to do, I'm completely absorbed in doing it. So now, is their mind disturbed? their mind may not be disturbed in terms of 10 different thoughts dragging them in different directions. But still, there is a difference between, there is a self-controlled person, there's a self-controlled person, and there's a self that is controlled by, there's a self who is in control of desires, and there's a self who is controlled by desires. We normally think of these two. Somebody, I've controlled my desires, is a self-controlled pure soul. Somebody is controlled by their desires, that's an impure, contaminated, conditioned soul. But in between could be a self that is controlled by one desire. That person from the material sense may be very purposeful. They work very hard, I want to become this, I want to win this Olympic gold medal, I just work extremely hard to achieve it. So the self is controlled by one desire. Now in that sense they may not be disturbed. But from the ultimate perspective, how valuable is that? Now, with the Olympic gold medal is a great thing. I was in India once, I was going on a train, and I saw in the distance somebody standing and wearing a bead bag. So I was so happy, I went at this. I said, talk with him, says, sir, when were you introduced to bhakti? He says, when you've been chanting? He says, what is chanting? I said, what is this? I said, this is a bead bag. He says, this is not my bead bag, this is my nail bag. He says, what do you mean? He said he was actually competing to enter into the Guinness Book of World Records. So he had made a nail super long. And that nail was kept in his nail bag.
So just recently I read a news that I don't know whether it's the same person, maybe some other person. Just 1 month ago I read a news that this person, he got the record of having the longest nail. And he entered in the Guinness book, but after that when he cut his nail, he found that his finger had become atrophied. Because he had never used that finger, because he was so afraid that if I move my finger, then the nail may break. So he had kept the nail like that, now he has lost the use of the finger itself. So now he's completely fixed, you know, that I want to protect my nail so that I can enter the Guinness book of world records. So you could say at one level the self-control by one desire, I want to enter the Guinness book of world records. But from the spiritual perspective, still disturbed. So the point I'm making here is that as long as our mind is disturbed, no matter how many time-saving devices we create, the disturbed mind will create engagements for us. And we will always stay overstressed. So stress can sometimes be caused by situations. And yes, there are stressful situations, no doubt in life, sometimes. But stress is fundamentally caused by our own disorganized and wild thoughts. And as long as these thoughts are going to continue, no matter how many things we create to save time, we will, even the save time we'll use in other things. And ultimately we will end up with very little time. So more than saving time through time-saving devices, we need to learn to save time by organizing our thoughts, by purifying our thoughts. So, the time-saving devices can be very useful if we have our mind in control. If we want to study and say write a research paper, in the past, we may have to go to a library or go to different libraries and find the research papers. Now today, with technology, we could just search on Google and find that. So we can save a lot of time for doing research. But if the mind is not controlled, you can sit in one room and you know, sometimes people get hooked to video games and they can spend days and days just playing video games and they just their life may go away like that. So that's why it's just as we are focusing on technological development externally, we need to also focus on spiritual development internally. Since I often say when I give science and spirituality seminars in colleges and companies, I say that Science can improve things, but it's only spirituality that can improve people. So when we improve things without improving people, then the improved things end up being used for destructive purposes. But when we give equal energy at least, or at least a significant amount of energy to improve ourselves internally, then whatever external improvements are there, we'll be able to use them more productively. Okay, how much time do we have? Yes, Mataji. Okay. Yes, Mataji. I'll come to you. Yeah.
So it's about your last class today about.
Okay, can you just come back to ask her questions about this class first? They can ask me personally also after the class. About this class?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So this fact of going to going back to Godhead or Brahmaloka, in your writings and lectures, Prabhu, whatever I have learned and read in your this one or two books, you have given a very kind of more contemporary proofs of reincarnation, like, you know, different four different theories. Do we have a kind of similar proof or, you know, some kind of validation of going back to Godhead or Brahmaloka? Like, a lot of these spirituality, you know, ideas are at the end, our desire is a spiritual desire and we want to go to Krishna Loka.
Okay,
we have to take that as words of the scriptures, or do we have a kind of more contemporary?
Okay, yeah, good question. So, if we say at the end of our life we'll go back to Godhead, is this something we just have to accept based on faith in scripture, or is it something which can be rationally understood? Okay. I'll talk about this in three ways. It can be a whole class in itself, but first is, we'll talk about the existence of the spiritual world. Second is the existence of a benevolent God as the Lord of the spiritual world. And the third is our destination when we go from this world. So first is, if we look at our life itself, all of us have a longing to live forever and to love forever. Every single living being longs to live forever. Now, if we are simply creatures of matter, if we were, then why would we have a desire to live forever? There is nothing in our vicinity anywhere that stays forever. If there's an African child living in a remote tribal location, one day suddenly tells his mother, "Mummy, I want a pizza." First question the mother would ask is, where did you hear about a pizza? There's nothing in your circumstance. So similarly for us, there is nothing around us that lasts forever. So where does our desire to live forever come from? It doesn't come from our external. It comes from our core. So if right now on this floor, we suddenly see a gold coin, there's nothing like a gold coin anywhere, we'll ask, where did the gold coin come from? Or maybe this somebody has a treasury from which the gold coin has come. So like that, if we understand that we have a longing for immortality that comes from our core, that is as out of place here like a gold on a stone floor. So that longing for immortality and its source indicates that there is an abode of immortality. It's an inference. There is no... For that which is spiritual, you cannot have any conclusive proof unless we experience it. What we can have is reasonable inferences. And the other option is that we can conclude that there's nothing beyond it. But then there's no explanation for our immortality, our longing for immortality at all. Second point is that if we understand that, if we observe the world around us and if we understand the basic bhakti philosophy, we do understand that God exists and God loves, God cares. That's why he has arranged for the world, he has arranged for his own descent to the world, he has given his scriptures. So if we understand in principle that there is a benevolent God who arranges for the world. Now, of course, we may see some things going wrong in the world. Many things may be going wrong also in the world. But sometimes atheists say that so many bad things are happening in the world, how can there be a good God? How can there be a God who is good? But actually speaking, if we take atheism to its strict logical conclusion, atheism does not allow for the very categories of good or bad. Good or bad is a moral judgment. And
when a lion pounces on a deer and eats it, is it good or is it bad? For the deer it is bad, for the lion it is good. So if we were purely materialistic creatures, then we are driven simply by our genes to survive and reproduce. Then if that's all that is meant for, that is all what life is meant for, then what is the conception of what good and what is the conception of bad? Or if you go at an even more fundamental level, everything that exists is simply an interaction of insentient atoms and molecules, or even insentient fundamental particles. So then they have no conception of good or bad. So when atheists ask why is there evil in the world, they are presuming the existence of conceptual categories such as good and evil that have no rationale in the atheistic worldview at all. So we ask why bad things happen to. So the way somebody asks is, if people say if this whole analysis seems a little complex, why do bad things happen to good people? So then you can turn around, why should bad things not happen to good people? Say, no, but good things should happen to good people, bad things to bad. But why? Who said that? Is that a law of physics? No, in physics there is no such thing as good or bad. So basically, the very fact that we ask why do bad things happen to good people implies that we presume the existence of some natural order in which good should lead to good and bad should lead to bad. And then we can ask, where does this order come from? And then we can ask, okay, why is this order apparently violated sometimes? But the point is that the existence of God as a benevolent being who has created the order in the world, that is a reasonable inference. If I see 100 rooms in a house, in a mansion, and 99 of them are very spick and span, neat and tidy, and one is completely disorganized, I can look at that one room which is disorganized and ask, why is this so unclean? And I can say, there is no housekeeper. Yeah. Nobody is doing housekeeper. I can look at the 99 and I can say that there must be a housekeeper. And maybe there is some reason why this room is unclean. So, for us, when we ask why do bad things happen to good people, we ask that because normally we expect and we experience that when we do something good, we do get a good result. So 99 rooms are clean and one is unclean. So having this, again I said each of these points can become whole class. But the third point now, if you understand that there is a benevolent God, then the purpose of life in the world is twofold. It's experimentation and rectification. It means when we want to enjoy life in various materialistic ways, separate from God, the world offers us facilities for doing that. But if we want to turn towards God, the world offers us facility for that also. So if God is benevolent and the world is a facility for both experimentation and rectification, then if somebody tries to live a life that is devoted to God, there is no reason for God to keep this person in this world. If we wish to devote ourselves to God, if we wish to serve Him, then why would He keep us in a place where there are so many distractions from serving Him? Why would He not take us to a place where we could serve Him continuously? So therefore, if we devote ourselves to Krishna in this life, then it's a reasonable inference that Krishna will reciprocate with us by taking us to Him. Now, of course, if we have not yet developed that strong a desire to attain Krishna, then we may have to go to some other place in the material world where some of our other desires are fulfilled, and then eventually we go to Krishna. But if we are devoting ourselves to Krishna, if I was intensifying our desire for serving Krishna, then why would He not take us to Him? So the question here is that we cannot have conclusive proof what to speak of somebody going back to Godhead. From the material perspective, we can't even have conclusive proof of the existence of God or the existence of the kingdom of God. But what we can have in logic, there is called as a there is a this forward reasoning and backward reasoning. Forward reasoning means that we make some reasonable reasonable axiomatic assumptions and we reason forward from them. Backward reasoning is that we look at the state of affairs now and then we trace backwards to the cause. So generally in historical sciences we can do backward reasoning, where scientists infer to the best explanation by looking at the present and what led to the present. But for some things in the future we have to do forward reasoning. So if we look at the state of affairs in today's world, we arrive at certain reasonable inferences, and from that by forward reasoning we can come to a reasonable conclusion that if somebody devotes themselves to God then they will attain the kingdom of God. Okay, thank you. Yeah, I think I should stop here. So thank you very much for your attention. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna. Everyone who is here, you can take one book of Prabhuji from us, me.